Welcome everybody on the live show. This is your host Adamic Sud, all the way from Albany, New York. Guys, I'm excited to come to you, to your house, to your business, no matter where you're watching from. I'm excited. I believe God's going to bless you today. God's going to speak to your heart, inspire you, encourage you. I believe it is your time. It is your season to receive the blessings of God. I believe tonight somebody's about to get touched by the Holy Spirit. I want you to guys take a moment. Real quick, share this video on your Facebook timeline with your family, friends, and invite everybody on. Make sure you bring everybody on this broadcast. You can tag somebody name, tag their name right below this video, and let them know that we are live and we have a special guest, Pastor Cliff, all the way from New Zealand. It is small world. With this technology, we can now connect people all over the world, and it is amazing to have people all over the world that are coming on. And give me a favor real quick. Take a moment to share this broadcast on your Facebook timeline. Invite somebody on and let everybody know that we are live. And also take a moment to type right below. Let us know where you guys are watching from. We always love to, you know, hear people are watching from different parts of the world and people are being blessed and people are being encouraged, inspired to step out of their comfort zone. We want to know that, guys, and continue. Let us know where you guys are watching from, and we want to, you know, speak to you, speak to everybody that are watching and who will be watching later on. And here we go, my special guest, all the way from New Zealand, Pastor Cliff Cherry, the senior pastor of Red Point Church, New Zealand. So, here, Pastor, take a moment to introduce yourself.
Hey everybody! Well, just want to say it's a real honor and a privilege to be on the program tonight. So, man of God, I just want to thank you, and just really say you're doing an amazing job in terms of spreading the gospel far and wide. And isn't technology amazing that I can be sitting here in New Zealand and you're on the other side of the world, and we can be having this conversation about what Jesus is doing on the earth today. So, I just greet everybody in the name of Jesus. It's great to see you tonight. We'll just encourage you to come hungry and expectant, and even during this broadcast, just believe for God to touch you right where you're sitting. If it's healing you need, if it's a breakthrough you need, we know that we have a Heavenly Father who's able to reach across time and space and reach you wherever you are. So greetings from the land of the long white cloud, as they call it, Aotearoa, New Zealand, all the way on the other side of the earth. Nice to see you.
Amen. Praise the Lord. So, Pastor, we have a lot of people on, even on my our Facebook page, on my profile. We have a lot of people from South Africa, and you were born and raised in South Africa. Tell us a little bit about, you know, how that transition worked in your life. You were in South Africa, you were called, and you transitioned. You were pastoring a church in South Africa, but you transitioned over to New Zealand. Tell us a little bit about that. How did that happen? And during that time, what changes happened in your life?
Yeah, sure. Well, I mean, I was born in South Africa, born in Johannesburg, and my parents got divorced at about the age when I was about 4 years old, and so we grew up with my mum and would sort of see my dad every second weekend. My dad worked really hard. I'd probably look back now and think he was a bit of a workaholic. So even on the weekends when we would see him, we didn't really see him because he was busy working, and my mum got saved shortly after they got divorced, and she took us to church, to Sunday school in Johannesburg. And at about the age of 13, she said, look, you've got to make up your own mind whether you want to be at church, whether you want to follow Jesus. And at that stage, I decided there were some other things I wanted to do with my life. And so I got mixed up with the wrong group of friends, got involved in things that I shouldn't have got involved in. And basically one day met a girl who went to a church. And her parents, if I look back now, I think, man, it's crazy that they did this. Her parents said to me, you can date our daughter as long as you do two things. You come to church on a Sunday and you come to home group on a Sunday night. Wow. And so I figured, well, that's not too bad. You know, that I can handle that. And it was during that time, I'd been at the church about 3 months. And I was just sort of in my final year of school. I was 17 and a half years old. And I can very clearly remember going with this girlfriend of mine, her dad, to church one Sunday. Mm-hmm. And man, God just got hold of my heart. I, you know, when you're in your final year of school, you're trying to put on a sort of a tough, brave, bravado kind of look about it. And I walked into the church and I just started to weep uncontrollably. People were coming next to me. They were hugging me. They were giving me tissues. They were praying for me. It was all like totally crazy. I mean, I didn't even know what was going on. But the man that preached, a man by the name of Pastor Jim Lamont, incredible man of God, he preached on Philippians 1:21, and which is for me to live is Christ and to die is gain. And he asked the question that day, in a hall with about 700 people, who are you really living for? And I just knew that it had to be Jesus Christ. And so I put my hand up. Myself and one other gentleman walked to the front of the church in front of 700 people that day. And I would say that's the day that I really encountered Jesus, that he touched me and that he saved me. So that was at the age of 17. I then went down and studied a year of journalism at a university on the coast of South Africa. Was part of an amazing, amazing church down there, incredible leaders. And it was during that year that God said to me, look, you're not going to be a journalist. You're not going to be anything else other than a preacher of the gospel. And so it was during that time that I moved back up to Johannesburg. And shortly after going back to the church where I was born again at, they invited me to join their pastoral team. Incredible, incredible leaders there, Pastor Marcus and Adele Herbert, who played a significant role in my life in those early days in helping me get to that place. So I was on that team for 5 years, served that church, loved the church, loved South Africa. And then God started to put New Zealand on my heart, of all places. I mean, I think, South Africa and New Zealand, you can't really get two further places apart. I mean, it's a long, long way away. And it was really at a barbecue, or what South Africans would call a braai, that I met a man who was leading a church in Auckland, Pastor Michael Nicholas. And God started to align our hearts. And it was in 2007 that between him and me and others, we really realized that New Zealand was where I needed to be. And so they invited me over to come and join their pastoral team in New Zealand. So I was unmarried, I was a single man. In 2007, said goodbye to all my family at the airport in Johannesburg. Literally got on a plane, not entirely sure what I was going to do, except I knew I was going to be part of this amazing church. And so that's how God really got me from South Africa. I mean, it's the short version, but it's how God got me from South Africa to New Zealand. And just, amazing to see how God can work and how He can move people and get them to the different places that He wants them to be. So if there's anyone sitting here on the program tonight believing for divine direction, I honestly, not because of anything I've done, but just a living example of what God has done, and how He can move you right across the world for His
Come on.
purposes in His time, open up all the doors that need to be opened up to get you to where He needs to get you to. So it's an exciting life. I mean, I don't think I'd want to be doing anything else other than serving Jesus, to be honest. It's just, I can't think of anything more exciting to be doing.
Amen. Praise the Lord. A lot of people have their own plan, and they want to do what they want to do. Like for example, Sarah and Abraham had their own plan, but all of a sudden, because they thought God even told Abraham that I'm going to give you a son, and out of that son, many a generation nation will born. And Sarah goes like, "No, you go marry Hagar." They got their own little plan. But I believe that God have a plan and purpose for each and everyone, no matter who you are, where you come from, what's your race, gender, background, the color of your skin. It doesn't matter, because if God kicks in and He can turn your lives ups and down, because that's the way Sarah thought, that's how it's supposed to happen. But no. What God said, that's how it's supposed to happen, because on the very time the Bible says, on a perfect time, and the Sarah has a baby in her hand. So maybe you're going through some tough time, and you're probably waiting on God. God, I don't know what to do with my life. I don't know what to do with everything that is around me. I'm struggling in my life, but I want to encourage you. Trust God and keep moving, because God has a great purpose and plan for your life, and He's gonna bless you beyond your expectation, because God is a God of perfect timing, and He is ready to bless somebody. So, Pastor, also tell us, your personal experience. How did you come to know Jesus Christ, as your personal Savior? But because a lot of people out there, they think that they have to have an Apostle Paul experience, where the lightning shining on you, and you fall off your horse, and you gotta go blind, so God to open your eyes. So they're over to your back.
Oh, thank you. Well, thankfully, I've never fallen off a horse, so that's all right. But what you say is so true. For me, when I found myself, it was a process that actually took place over 3 months. And I don't know if my heart was really hard or what the story was, but I sat in this church for 3 months, listening to the preaching, watching people worship. And to be quite honest, the first few Sundays I was there, I thought they were a little crazy, you know, people raising their hands, singing, what is this? But what I couldn't deny was the people that were in that church. I would walk away every Sunday and think, I don't believe what they believe, but it's very clear that they believe what they believe. You know, people don't just worship like that and don't just weep like that if they're not truly being touched and truly believe in what they're doing. And so that, along with the word that was preached, spoke tremendously to me. And it was that one Sunday morning when I was just there with this girl's dad that the lady got up behind the keyboard and she started to play a song. It was one of the Vineyard songs, "Draw Me Close to You," and it just hit me. And I couldn't turn it off. I just started to weep, and I was almost feeling very embarrassed because it's your final year of school and you're trying to present this bit of a tough guy image, and here I am bubbling. I mean, literally bubbling. And I didn't fully understand what it was, but I look back now and I know I was just being hit with the love of God. I suddenly realized that he wasn't there to judge me, he wasn't there to kill me, he wasn't there to wipe me from the face of the earth. He was calling me home. He was my father. And having had an absent father for a large part of my life, to actually encounter my heavenly father was one of the most freeing, incredible experiences of my life. And I know that day, that was probably the first day that I really encountered the tangible presence of God.
Come on.
And I just couldn't do anything else. That when the man who was preaching got up and said, he preached out of Philippians 1:21, and he said, "Come on, you need to give your life to Christ." It was like something was literally burning on the inside of me. My heart was beating fast, and I didn't even fully understand what I was doing. I just knew I had to answer that question and give my life over to Jesus. And so I think you find a lot of people, they want to have everything lined up and they want to know what the beginning from the end is going to be. And if I make this decision, what's it going to entail? I could never have guessed in my wildest dreams that I would be doing what I'm doing today back then at that point. But all I knew was this, was I needed to take the next step. You know, God convicted me. He said, "Cliff, you're living your own way. You're living in sin, but come to me and I'm going to erase all of that. Come to me. I'll send my son. I'm going to erase all of that. I'm going to call you in and I'm going to teach you what it's like to be my son." And it all happened on that Sunday morning. I mean, I actually left the church and I went home and had a long sleep because I'm a very emotional experience. But I knew I'd encountered the resurrected Jesus. I knew he was
Come
real.
on.
I can't say that I had a vision. I can't say that there was anything else happening except what was happening inside my heart. But there's no ways anybody could tell me that it wasn't real. And so God had just revealed himself to me. And literally what I needed as a broken young man was I needed love. And that's what he poured out on me that day. And I just couldn't cope in that sense with just the amount of love that was being poured on me. So I just ended up weeping. I wept through the worship time. I think I was even crying during the announcements. You know, the guys were giving the announcements at the church. And
Wow.
then this man got up to preach and I just wept through the sermon. And I just knew, come on, Cliff, today's the day. You've got to give your heart to Jesus Christ. Yeah.
Wow. That's a powerful experience, you know, because all of us are going to have a different experience. You know, Apostle Paul had a different experience. Peter had a different experience after 3 times denying Jesus Christ, even spending time with him. But when he begins to weep, he begins to realize that what he missed. You know, we got to understand, all of us, that we're not going to have the same experience in our life. You know, and we're not going to have Nathaniel have a totally different experience sitting in the under the tree and then coming to Jesus Christ and say, "How did you know me?" You know, and then everybody's going to have a different experience. I'm telling you, because I had a totally different experience when I'm born again, because I could feel the strong calling of God over my life. And that's how I got changed from the age of 12, and God brought me into his presence, even though I don't wanted to come in his presence. Even I wanted to become a businessman, but God like said to Jesus said to Peter that I'm gonna make you fisher of men. So there you go, that God is ready to you might not have a big worldwide ministry or big church or mega church, but if you can just walk over to your neighbor and say that Jesus loves you know, and if that person life is changed. There we go. So let's Pastor, you know, you have a church, and let's talk about your church. What is the mission and passion? What drives you to keep going? Because I know having a church is a big responsibility. And what keeps you going, even wife and children and all these things? So Eric, back to you.
Well, I mean, we're very blessed and privileged. My wife and I now get to pastor and lead a church on the east coast of the North Island of New Zealand in a town called Hastings. And coming up May this year, we'll have been here exactly 8 years. But our vision is really, really simple in the sense of it's to know Jesus, to make Jesus known, and to
Come on.
equip every believer to do what Jesus did in their unique gifting.
Yes.
And so you know, when I see people saved, when I see people encounter God, when I see people raised up and equipped and actually go and do what Jesus has called them to do, that's what I live for. You know, I live for that. My heart's desire and passion, it all revolves around saying, let's get as many people trained and equipped. I think probably, you know, I had a I would look back now and see God's hand in it, but at the time it was a disappointing experience. Speaking to someone who I greatly admired in the ministry, and I was trying to ask them a number of questions about the anointing and about healing and about deliverance, and they wouldn't tell me because they felt like, well, they knew it and they wanted to keep it so they could be the person that all the ministry could come from. And I remember leaving that saying, wow, Lord, I'm disappointed because I've had time with this person and I wanted to know. And I said to the Lord that day, I said, Lord, if you teach me, I will teach everybody that wants to listen. I'm not
Come
going to
on.
hold anything back. I want to see from the smallest child to someone that's maybe pressing into their 90s, know how to lay hands and see miracles, know how to preach the gospel, know how to operate in the unique gifting that God has given them. And so really for us, that's why our church exists now, is for that. We feel like we have the privilege of raising up men and women to actually be able to do what Jesus did. John 12 verse 14, you will do what I did and even greater. We take that scripture seriously, we take it literally, and it's really has become the driving momentum behind what we're wanting to do. And we've recently just sent a team to the Solomon Islands to help plant a church as well as minister on the island there. And some of the people that were on that team have only been saved since April last year. Yet they were laying hands on the sick, and they were seeing the sick healed, and they were seeing demons come out and miracles taking place. And so that's what I live for, man. I just want to train and equip everybody to be able to do it. I feel blessed and privileged that I get to do it, but we want to train others as many as we can, because the world's a big place. I mean, I think 7 billion people on the planet. We need
Come
an
on.
army raised up across the world that can go into all of these places, some of the remote places on the earth, and actually be able to take the gospel and not just words, but know how to flow in the power of God.
Come
So
on,
that for
praise the
us,
Lord.
that's what we're here for. That's why our church is here. That's why I'm pastoring. And look, I love people. I mean, and I love seeing the lights come on for people. I love it when I see people walking in their God-given destiny. That floats my boat. And so
Nice.
we feel really blessed. I mean, there's no doubt there's challenges to pastoring. You'll know that yourself. There's
Yes.
challenges to leading a church, but honestly, it's all worth it when you see people come to Christ and then you see them raised up into what God's called them to.
Amen. Wow, that's powerful because, when you're leading a multiple churches, and it's really challenging because you're not just only overseeing the leadership, but you're also looking at the growth of the church and the health of the church, and you're also looking at the people, how they are growing, and what is the next step that you're gonna take to grow people. It's not just a selfishness things because leader. I just love that. I read the title of the book. It said "Leader Eats Last." So I was thinking about because. You first of all put other people ahead of you to put them to a place or the path of success so they can succeed. I love Maxwell. I don't know if you read John C. Maxwell, but I read a
Yes.
lot of his books. He said if you climbing up a mountain and if you get up there on the top all by yourself, then you're not a leader, you're a hiker. So
I like that.
leader go with people. If you are on the top all by yourself, then you're not leading well, because you gotta have leader goes with their people and leader lead people, not force them to be led. And I just really felt encouraged. That's what drives me as well, leadership, because leadership is my passion. And I believe if we want to lead people, we have to have an influence with people. And we gotta love them before we ask them to be led. So people likes to be loved because nobody like average leader or leader that they don't like. Nobody wants to follow a person that who don't like. That's a great example of Jesus Christ. People love Jesus, because he loved even prostitutes, or he loved even tax collectors, and he eat with them. So he created an influence and a bond with them, so people could see the love in Jesus' eyes. So we gotta be example of Jesus Christ. We gotta have love in our eyes in order to preach the gospel. I believe that the gospel of Jesus Christ was not spread on the sword, but with love. What do you think, Pastor Cliff?
Absolutely, it's all about love. It's all about loving people, and we've had some amazing sort of testimonies in the last couple of months. You know, people that arrive at the church, and they're all in different places. Some have wanted to argue with me at the end of the service about what was preached, but just love them. And some of the people that were in that place 6 months ago become some of the most incredible members of our church now. They're reaching out. They're knocking on people's doors. Believing God, to do great things. And so it all starts with loving people. I think if you're going to be involved in any kind of ministry, obviously Jesus at the center, but apart from that, you've got to love people. You've just got to be there to love people.
It's a great example of that's how you get to lead people. It's powerful. So I see people are watching from Jamaica. It's Jamaica in the house. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. I see my good friend Charlene watching from Wyoming. That's awesome. And guys, let us know where you guys are watching from. We would love to pray for you. We would love to pray for your country, nation. Pastor Cliff Cherry is all the way from New Zealand. So it is amazing that he's doing a church there. I want you to follow his page and follow his ministry. If God leads you to, contribute, bless, sow a seed. I believe that God will bless you in regards to that. And he's doing an amazing work. I had the opportunity to connect with him, and I'm excited to, for this connection, because God is already using him in the same way. So if both of us heading in the same direction, why don't just connect and help each other to get in the same direction. So I love it. So I need you to guys continue to type your prayer requests right below this video, because we want to pray for you, pray for your healing, deliverance, breakthrough. If you're struggling, we want to pray for you. And because that's a great example of Jesus Christ. If he will leave the 99 and go after one. So if you are that one, we want to come after you and pray for you and help you lift up. So, Pastor, before we get into prayer, I also want to give you opportunity to talk about is any book are you writing any book, or any book is coming out?
I've got a few books on my heart. They've yet to be written, so I'm still a young man. I like to think I'm a young man. So there's gonna be time for that. But the Lord is definitely stirring me. I've had a number of prophetic words about doing that, and so I would imagine in the next couple of years we'll put some pen to paper and let it come out. And I just want to be divinely directed by what God's called me to say and do. So yeah, I think that's we'll see that probably come in the future.
Amen. Praise the Lord. So what about in a perspective of traveling? Are you traveling anywhere or doing anything in any ministry?
Yeah, we are. So we have the privilege, my wife and I have been part of an apostolic team called New Covenant Ministries International, and in partnership with them, we go around the world and we actually help strengthen churches, plant churches. And so there's that's taking place, and then there's also some other things that God has actually opened up to us. And so we've spent a lot of time in Australia, a lot of time in Indonesia. I've previously been into the Middle East, and so I count it an absolute privilege to be able to travel and be able to help other local churches and other leaders. Just last weekend, we were in another town in New Zealand with a great, great church, and had the privilege of seeing nearly 30 people respond in the altar call to either give their heart to Christ for the first time or to rededicate their lives. And then we just saw God break out in miracles and actually heal people in the meeting. And so it's been a tremendous privilege. I think the apostolic is something that burns deep within us. Some of the people that God has connected us to historically, as well as now, one of them being Dr. Rodney Hart Brown, an amazing man of God.
Come on,
You can't
Florida.
hang around these people and not want to be someone who actually takes the gospel out. And so my wife and I count it a privilege that we get invited to different places and have the privilege of going to different countries and different churches to minister, in addition to the great joy of actually leading a local church here.
Amen. Praise the Lord. That's really amazing and powerful. Love Dr. Howard Brown out of Florida, originally from South Africa. So this is really amazing man of God, really great wisdom. So it's incredible, you know, what God actually doing. So tell us about what's happening in New Zealand. Is a revival is you know stirring up? What do you see in New Zealand? How the people are? How they're What their response is, since you have the church there, what's your strategy?
I think what we're seeing in New Zealand now is I think we're seeing people are tired of religion, and there seems to be a genuine hunger of people actually seeking out the presence of God. And so my personal conviction is I believe churches that allow the Holy Spirit to do what he wants to do when they gather and allow his presence to be there, those are the churches that are going to be growing into the future. You know, when everything's totally programmed out, sometimes we program God right out of everything that we're doing. And I've found that there's a whole lot of people that are actually hungry and saying, Cliff, we just actually want the presence of God. We want the reality of his presence. It doesn't matter if we're going to be in the building for an hour and a half, 2 hours, 2.5 hours. We're hungry. And I'm starting to see that take place in New Zealand. And really, that's what we need at this point in time. You know, and I believe it started to actually take place. And I believe that's going to continue. And my heart's cry and desire is that we're going to see the church is going to be something to be reckoned with in this nation once again. You know, New Zealand's got an incredible history of people being born again and missionaries being sent out to different places. And that slipped away in recent years. But I believe God's put us here for such a time as this to actually see that revived and to see the
Amen.
name of Jesus preached again in our land. There's some great things happening, even for us locally in our city. In terms of our city council, some of the local city councils have come to Christ and been born again, and that's having an impact. And we're really starting to see, even in our city, the church being seated at the table in some major decision-making things, and being able to offer wisdom and perspective. And so I'm quite excited about it, you know. But I think, you know, I'm always going to be looking for the opportunities. I believe we've got to be looking for the best of what God's doing. I speak to some people who are very negative about what's happening in New Zealand in the church, and I just say, no, there's a remnant that's being raised up that God's got his hand on, and that there's a group of hungry people. And really, how many people does God need to actually shake a nation? Not many, just some hungry people, and the Lord will raise them up. And I believe we're seeing that right across the nation. I'm hearing amazing testimonies of churches that are having incredible encounters with God in their meetings and seeing an outflow of people being touched and changed. So it's not just a case of arrive at 10 and leave at 11:15, and we've done our thing. But people are really starting to press in and believe God, and waiting on Him. So personally, I'm excited. I believe God called me to this nation for that reason. I didn't get on a plane and come 12,000 kilometers just to do church. We've come here to see this nation change for the gospel of Jesus Christ.
Come on, that's a powerful. I just feel the goosebumps, you know. That's so exciting when you say that we are not here to do church, but to be a church. That's powerful. So praise the Lord. So everybody, as you guys typing your prayer requests right below, I want you to continue keep typing. So we're gonna pray for you right now. So I believe that God's gonna bless you. And some of people that who are watching right now, I need you to guys share this video. Please, please, please share this video. Give us a favor so we can get this word all over the world. We have right now between my page and the Vision TV page, so 320,000 followers on a Vision TV page and 100 almost 130,000. So we are talking half almost you know half a million people over here. So praise the Lord. So this is amazing. So Vision TV is reaching 20 million people per month. And this is incredible. I have seen a great testimonies, people telling me from all over the world. I was just somebody was inviting me Papua New Guinea, and they were telling me that it's not too far from New Zealand. But I was like, oh wow, that's amazing because I heard about this island. I've been there, but I was like really encouraged that people from all over the world, Hong Kong, Taiwan, people from Indonesia, a lot of we have people in Nigeria. I've been inviting to. A lot of people that we have on, you know, followers from Africa, all different parts of the, you know, African countries. So encouraged, inspired to see all people are being encouraged, inspired, and a lot of prayer requests we are receiving. So some of the prayer requests even I received in over on our profile. So I'm just gonna real quick read some of the prayer requests, and I'm gonna have Pastor. Pastor Cliff to pray for everybody. So it's going to be awesome. It's going to be great. So There you go, Pastor. I'm gonna have you actually start the prayer, and because right now I think it's gonna be very low, 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 low. So all the way is hiding here. Okay, so a lot of people asking for prayer for healing, deliverance, breakthrough. A lot of people are asking God to, you know, help them with their relationship, with their finance, and a lot of people are asking that if God can really help change their lives. So, a lot of people that is, you know, going through a lot of discouragement. People want to set this year a new goal, and they want to make a right decision. So, let's real quick prayer, Pastor. I'm gonna give over to you, sir. So you can speak power, healing, and the power of God over their life. And as soon as I find it, later on, I will also, you know, send you to your messenger. So you can just read all the prayer requests. And then you can, when you find a time, in your quiet time, you can lay your hands on those prayers and you can pray for all those people. Over to you, Pastor Cliff.
Be an absolute privilege to do that. So let's just start off by praying for those who need healing. And what I'd encourage you to do is either lay your hand on your chest or your head, or even if you can touch the part of your body where it's not well. And we've got a Heavenly Father who loves us so much, and He's paid for our sin and He's paid for our sickness. And so we believe today the power of God can touch you right where you are and you can be free. We've seen many, many people healed, and I know that God wants to heal today. So Amen. Heavenly Father, I just thank you for your goodness.
Yes.
I just thank you, Lord Jesus, that you are the healer. And I thank you that on the cross, you not only took our sin, but you took our sickness. And so right now, in the name of Jesus, I thank you for your power to touch every single person that has sickness in their body. And right now, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, I take authority over every sickness, every disease that is in your body right now. And I command it to leave you now in the name of Jesus. You cannot exist in a son and a daughter of God. You will go now. We break the power of sickness off of your life today in Jesus' name. And from the top of your head to the soles of your feet, I declare now that you be healed and whole from the top of your head to the soles of your feet. Some of you are going to start to even feel right now, I can feel it. You're going to feel sort of like a burning or a fire running through your body. You're going to feel the power of God beginning to touch you. And you can send the testimonies in later, but I can feel it even now. I feel the power and the presence of God even now. People are being touched right now as they're watching, and God is beginning to heal them and bring healing to their bodies. And Lord, you know every other prayer request that's out there. Lord, people that are looking for direction, people that need to be blessed financially, Father, people that are just stuck in wherever, whatever they're stuck in. I thank you today, Lord, that there would be a great freedom that would come across every person that's watching this. Lord, that every need would be met. Lord, you know you're a good Father. And I declare your will, your plans, your purposes, your destiny over them today, right now, in the name that is above every name, the name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen. Wow, that's a powerful prayer. So if you open your messenger, Pastor, you'll be able to see it. Some of the prayer requests I asked people a couple, probably a week ago, asked people, how can I pray for you? So we had over almost a lot of prayer requests, over 1,000 prayer requests. And some of the prayer requests that I prayed, that video I just posted, it's reached over 7,000 views, because I just see out there people desperately need prayers, because people need for other people to pray, not just only over the TV, but people likes to be acknowledged, and I really love that part. So a lot of prayers here. Shabha said Mount Zion King mission growth and financial breakthrough and salvation for the nation. Prayer for my daughter. Yolanda said my daughter has fibroids, and Mary asked, please pray for my mother. And Melanie asked, job interview today, receiving it, amen. So she receiving it by faith. And Ida said, I need the meeting of the minds and heart of my children, for they do not abide the fifth commandment of God. All right. So here Colleen said, my daughter Katie has been sick since Christmas. On her second round of antibiotics for infection, she's unable to take care of her family, needs healings. So Anne said, I need prayer for my healing. I need prayer for myself. I need help with my attitude and not to be too grouchy. So there's a lot of prayer requests. So I already forwarded over to you, sir. Thank you so much for praying
Thank
for
you.
people. And I believe that people is going to receive answers to their prayer. If you continue to have belief and trust in God's unfailing love, He will answer your prayers. You got to keep going. Even the when and devil is trying to manipulate you, trying to tell you not going to happen. You got to keep believing in God and keep climbing, keep priming up, and let God know, God, I am not leaving until I receive my miracle. Like Hannah, she would not leave the presence of God, and Eli, sitting at the doorpost, thought that she was drunk. But she was not drunk, but she was a drunk of God's wine, and she was just asking God to give her a son, and she would not leave until she received a word of confirmations. I decree and declare over your life in the mighty name of our Lord Jesus Christ. This is a confirmation for you that you better wash your face and go home because God is getting ready to release a miracle in your life. God is a God of miracle. He's a God of perfect timing. I believe it is your season. It is your time to receive your miracle. God has not forgotten about you. A lot of people think that God's forgot about you. No, God haven't forgotten about you. He loves you unconditionally. There is no limit. There's no boundaries. He loves you with no conditions. Come on, everybody. Pastor, may I pray for you real quick?
Amen. Yeah, just before you do that, I just want to thank you and just say you are doing an amazing job in terms of getting the gospel out. And so I just want to commend you on that. You're an incredible man of God. And thank you for what you're doing. You know, it takes the whole body of Christ to do what needs to be done. But you're reaching people that I may never reach, and you're going into homes in who knows where, you know, all over the world. And so I just want to say, well done. Appreciate you and thank God for you.
Amen. Wow. Thank you so much. It means a lot to me, Pastor Cliff. So a real prayer over you, sir. Lord, we thank you for Pastor Cliff. We thank you for his life. We thank you for his wife. We thank you for the children. We thank you for whatever you place in his life. It's not an accident. It's a purpose of God to give everything he has, God. And all the places and nations that he'd been to, God, you brought him to this particular place, not by accident or by what he wanted, but you brought it. So your word can be fulfilled. God, I ask you to start open the doors of opportunities for him. In the mighty name of our Lord Jesus Christ, we pray for finance. We pray for protection. We pray for God favors over his life. Whatever he touched, wherever he goes, may the Holy Spirit be with him. Whisper to him, God, day and night so he can hear the voice of God. And so every single decision he makes, not by his own fleshly desire, but by the power of the Holy Spirit, make a wise decision for his children, for his church, for everybody's around him. May you make him a man of wisdom so people come to him like people would come to Solomon for the counsel. God, I thank you what you're about to do next in his life, because it's going to be bigger than him, bigger than what he have experienced before, because God is about to release something amazing and profound in your life. In Jesus' mighty name, I pray for children protection. I've ask for wisdom, favor, and also as they grow physically, we ask they grow spiritually. In Jesus' mighty name, we pray. And we also pray over those people that who are watching right now and who will be watching later on. As Pastor Cliff spoken the word over their life, let it be, God. Bible say where two or three people gather together by my name, I'm there. I believe we are here more than two or three people. May the Spirit of God overcome, overshadow over every single person that who are watching and who will be watching later on. God, every single person that watching, bring breakthrough in their life, because we pray with faith, not by our might, not by our power, but by the power of Holy Spirit. We pray in Jesus' mighty name. What people have experienced on the day of Pentecost, may people experience it again and again and again and again in their life. In Jesus' mighty name, we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Pastor, I feel so blessed to have you on this show, and thank you so much for taking out of your time. I know it's a time difference, but I believe that this connection is a divine connection. I thank you very much. And before you leave, I'm going to give over to you, say a final word of encouragement. And less than
Yeah,
a minute.
just to everybody that's watching, know this: Jesus loves you. He is for you. And he's never going to let you go. Put your trust in him, put your eyes on him, and he will bring you through whatever needs to be brought through. He will raise you up. Even if people have forgotten you, Jesus will never forget you. He loves you.
Amen. Wow, praise the Lord. Everybody, Pastor Cliff Cherry, all the way from New Zealand with us. And make sure you go on his website if you would like to find out more about his church, about his ministry. Go on the website. And if you felt in your heart that that's God, we're leading you to, bless, help with the ministry, do so. I believe God's gonna bless you in returns to that. So thank you, Pastor Cliff Cherry, coming on. I'm looking forward to having you back on the show with the
Thank
new
you.
book.
Thank you so much. And hopefully we'll see you in New Zealand again sometime.
Amen. Praise the Lord. I'm ready.
Bye
All right. Thank you, everybody, for coming on. Have a good night. Praise the Lord.